Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. Serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength.
Amen. It's so good to gather with you guys again this week. We hope that you're staying safe at home. That's why we're doing this this way, so you can stay safe at home. But another benefit of staying at home is that you can sing as loud as you want, and nobody will hear you but God. And God don't judge. So we're really grateful to be able to be here and sing these songs with you and pray and listen to the word proclaimed, and it's just a joyful thing. So we're going to keep singing.
Light in my darkness, peace for my soul. You are my rescue, you never let go. Light in my darkness, peace for my soul. You are my rescue. You never let go. And all my hope is in you, and all my strength is in you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you. Here in my weakness, always the same, your love is my shelter, your life is my way. And all my hope is in you, and all my strength is in you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you. And all my hope is in you, and all my strength is in you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you. Constant Savior, reign forever, Lord, you have my heart. A sure foundation, and all my hope is in you, and all my strength is in you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you. And all the earth beneath you, and all my life before you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you. With every breath, my soul will rest in you.
Good morning, Palmacia Presbyterian Church, and good morning, friends and visitors of Palmacia Presbyterian Church. My name is Kenny Hubble, and I'm one of the pastors on staff here at PCPC, and I'm grateful to be in worship with you today. In fact, this is the most excited I've been to be in worship for a long time. Roger, Blake, Rick, it is great to be in the place where I get to hear your voices live. John, it is great to be in partnership with you as we lead worship. Tech team, it is good to see you in this place at the good work you're doing. And I've missed you, virtual church. I'm so thankful that we still have a space to gather safely. As I look forward to Sunday in-person worship, I'm grateful to have this time with you all the same. Thank you for being a part of this community. If you are wondering why I have had such an enthusiastic beginning, it's because I have not been in this space for the last several weeks. My wife, McKay, and I have welcomed our first son into the world, our first child into the world, Bennett. And so we have been doing the work of trying to figure out this whole parenting thing. And I will report that it's a good thing. We are enjoying every bit of it. We are very tired. We covet your prayers for our sleep. It's not really possible to try to prepare for sleeping in 3 to 4 hour chunks. It's something that we're getting accustomed to, but again, keep praying for us. We are so grateful for the support that you have shown me and McKay and Bennett over this time. This is the right place for us to start our weeks. To gather and worship is a way to provide encouragement and hope in a sometimes hopeless world. There is a lot going on around us. We feel the tensions, the divisions, we feel financial burden, economic crisis, all the things surrounding pandemic and politics, and I just want to say this is a good place for us to be on this day. We come to church, we come to the community of faith in hopes that we can rely on one another, that we can lean into the hope found in Scripture and rely on the strength of Christ. Thank you for being in this place. Let's open with a word of prayer. Good and faithful God, you have called us to this time and place that we might gather in hopes of hearing you and experiencing your presence anew. We ask that you help us love you with all our heart, all our soul, and with all our might. We ask that you help us love one another as we love ourselves. God, these are things that we strive to do but struggle with. It is so important that we look inside and see the places that we might change, the places that your Spirit might transform us. Lord, I lift up all those who are contending with illness, who are sick or hurting. We lift up all those who are experiencing the stress of finances or job loss. Lord, you are our great rock and our refuge. Thank you for the ways that you preserve us and provide for us, even in difficult times. We thank you for the hope, peace, love, and joy found in your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I invite the congregation to extend the peace of Jesus Christ to one another.
Peace be with you.
The peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
We have two scriptures we are reading in this first part of worship this morning, the first coming from Deuteronomy in the 6th chapter. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead, and write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. And the second scripture is from the book of Leviticus in the 19th chapter. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, I'd like to invite our children's director, Allison Kelly, forward to present our third graders' Bibles for our morning's children's message. Thank you, Allison.
Welcome, friends. Worship is so much better when you are here with us. This morning, I want you to go find something in your house. I want you to go see if you can find a Bible, any translation, and anything that resembles a Bible. You could push pause and pick us back up when you find it. We're going to read together. You might have to get your parents to help you. I want you to find Matthew 22. And the way I find Matthew in a Bible is that I look at the Bible and go halfway in and open it. And then on the Newer Testament, the second half, I open it up again, and I am almost where we need to be in Matthew. Matthew 22, starting at verse 36. I want us to read this together. This is what the Pharisees asked Jesus. Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You must love your neighbor as you love yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commandments. Thank you for reading with me. I'd love it if you sent a picture to us this week of you reading the Bible with your parent or by yourself. Send it to us. Do you see all these Bibles here? You wonder who they're going to? You wonder what's in them? In this Bible is love. They are stories about God's love. And if you are a third grader, one of these books is for you, especially for you, because you are loved. And we will make sure that you receive a Bible this week and invite you to join us, along with your parents, for Bible Blitz next Sunday. Now, I want you to imagine that you are here this morning, that you are standing here with your parents, maybe your siblings, maybe your grandparents, maybe other family members, maybe even friends. Imagine that all the saints that have gone before you, the fourth graders this year, and the youth, and the young adults at college, they've all been standing here, surrounding you. They're surrounding you now. They're cheering you on. They're wanting you to be a part of this journey too. But don't just take our word for it. Don't take our word for it that this is an amazing book of love. Don't take the word of the last 3,000 years. Don't even take your parents' word for it. Because you know what? You're old enough now. You're old enough to interpret and open it and have wonderings and thoughts of your own as a third grader. We encourage you to have your own thoughts. We encourage you to read this in the community of faith and ask your friends and family what they think about it too. I want you to do three things with it. I want you to receive it, I want you to enjoy it, and I want you to learn along with it. Receive this gift of love in the Bible that's God's story of God's people and God's grace. And it goes with you at home, it can go with you wherever you are. I want you to enjoy it. Enjoy reading how God is at work around you in nature and throughout history. Learn along with it. Learn about the life and teachings of Jesus Christ and be open to how God may change you over the whole course of your life on this Reformation Sunday. When you spend time reading the scriptures in community, you will be changed. I know I have. Now, we all know we should love God and should love each other. But the hard part is knowing exactly how to do that. So we hope this book helps us, and it helps me, figure out how we can do that. Most of all, to be a good student of this book of love is to be doers of the word and not just hearers of the word. And by doing the word, we pray we will all fight a little less, and we will love a little more. All the laws and commandments are held inside and depend on love. And know that each of you, third graders and all God's children, you are all part of this story, God's great story of love too. Now, I want to bless all these books of love. Loving and gracious God, you are the fount and source of every blessing. You have revealed yourself to human creation in many diverse ways as we hold your scriptures in our hungry hands. Look with delight upon each of your third graders and each of your children today as we renew our commitment to read and remember you in the stories of salvation for us and for the world. Help us to absorb its wisdom and live out its inspired truth. Encourage us with the help of the Holy Spirit to use these sacred writings for our prayer and inspiration and for the increase in the building up of your kingdom. Through your word, let us be transformed into the very likeness of Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever. Amen.
What a wonderful tradition that is. We are so grateful for the third graders in our midst, and we hope that this was a meaningful time as you've received your Bibles here at PCPC. Friends, at this time, we move from the time with children into a moment of gratitude. And as I have seen on Facebook, seen on YouTube, have spoken with my colleagues and you, I'm so moved by the great generosity of this community. You have done so much to support the ministries of this place. You have done so much in supporting this community in itself. I drove into the church parking lot and I see our little free pantry, and that puts a smile on my face. Thank you for the ways that you give to this place. We hope that we will honor God with our tithes and offerings in this moment to continue this good work. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for the many ways that you have blessed us. You have shown your care for us in the form of resources and relationships, and we now ask a blessing upon these tithes and offerings, that they might become an extension of your love and grace in the world around us. We pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy. Amen.
It's great to have Kenny back. Welcome, Kenny. It was also great that he was able to go, and he and McKay were able to share that wonderful experience together. And thank you, Kenny and McKay, for helping us to be a part of the journey. We appreciate the pictures and the comments, and felt like we got to walk with you a little bit in that deeply important experience of the arrival of your first child. Welcome back. As we come back, I come to read the third scripture reading for today. This is a scripture that is coming from the Gospel of Matthew, the 22nd chapter, more towards the end of it now. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question: "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it: love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he?" "The son of David," they replied. He said to them, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. If you've been listening for several weeks now, you know that the question that comes to Jesus today is the last of three questions. This is a time, the first half of one particular week in Jerusalem, the Holy Week, as we call it now. The first half of this week in Jerusalem, after Palm Sunday and before Maundy Thursday, and the leaders of the community, the religious leaders and those who were the authorities in Jerusalem, upset by Jesus' disruption, upset perhaps by the way he came into the city hailed as a king, upset perhaps by what they likely experienced as his impertinence and driving the money changers out of the temple and his teaching in the temple, upset by the way in which he may have threatened their authority, but cognizant of the appeal he had for the people and the crowd, they try to catch Jesus. They try to trick him. And so they bring him three different questions. We looked at two of them, and now here comes the third. Each question is an attempt to discredit Jesus. The Pharisees are the last group of leaders. They've heard that he silenced, in his answer, the Sadducees. Now they test him. And note that that's the word in the text, in the scripture. They test him. Eugene Peterson, in his translation of this passage, puts it like this: "When the Pharisees heard how Jesus had bested the Sadducees, they gathered their forces for an assault. One of their religion scholars spoke for them, posing a question they hoped would show Jesus up: 'Teacher, which command in God's law is the most important?'" Now, this moment is captured in Mark's biography of Jesus and Luke's as well. They remember this moment as also occurring, but they find this moment a bit more of a friendly dialogue. Matthew remembers it as a fierce competition. It's not a friendly moment, as Matthew recalls it. Don Upton paraphrases it this way in the lectionary podcast this week: "They come as if to say, 'We've already arrived at our answers. Now we're testing you.'" This week, the week before, 2 weeks before this national election, all of the state and local elections with it, This week, as I've listened to the news, every question I hear doesn't seem like a real question, but a test, a trap. And here's the question they bring Jesus. Which commandment is the greatest? It's like looking at the Bibles that Allison's been presenting to the confirmation students and asking them, which verse is the most important of all of the verses in the Bible? Which commandment, of all of the commandments that are found in the Old Testament, which one is the most important? There were over at least 600 possibilities, some may much more. And they disagreed about which one was primary. Some said this, some said that. Which of the Ten Commandments do you think is the most important? Which scripture do you think is the most important scripture to memorize, Kenny? If you're just going to memorize one, which would it be? Which verse, Roger, do you think is more important? John 3:16, Psalm 23, or is it perhaps Romans 8? It's not a test, but it was for Jesus. Do you think the Lord's Prayer is the most important prayer in the Bible to memorize? You see, real quickly, this sort of test can create divisions. If it had been me, I would have just have avoided the question altogether. Have you ever dealt with a possible disagreement by simply avoiding it? But note that Jesus doesn't dodge the moment or the question. He doesn't slip away. And I think that's perhaps the first point that we can draw out of this story. Engage the test. Sometimes in the test itself, it is the neighbor you are encountering. Jesus receives the question, the test, and answers it directly. It's a testimony to the character of Jesus and his knowledge of the scriptures. And he answers by saying, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart." And then he adds a second to it. The first comes from the book of Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter. It's a critical portion of the Hebrew scriptures, and it has its own name. It's called the Shema. It's a prayer that observant Jews would recite the first thing upon rising in the morning and the last thing before going to bed at night. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and as Matthew says it, with all your mind." But Jesus then adds a second to it from the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 18. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." This first, the Shema, is so important that oftentimes observant Jews would write it on a scroll and place it in a mezuzah. I've got one here. It's a small container that I think mimics the larger containers that would carry the Torah. And they will place this on their doorways. Have you seen one of these before? And so there are a number of them in homes here in Tampa. And their practice is and was, as they would leave the house, they would touch the scroll, the mezuzah, and as they would come into the home, they would touch it again. It's a way of kind of materializing the prayer, because inside, enscrolled on it, was this verse from Deuteronomy. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, in all your mind." Jesus is saying that this is at the heart of the commandments, and the second he puts with it from Leviticus, "Love your neighbor as yourself." I want to ask you, what would you put on your mezuzah? What would you write down inside? What would you want to touch every time you leave and every time you come back in? This was deep in their bones, you see. This scripture from Deuteronomy. And Jesus is adding this second to it to have deep within them as well. Do you have any scripture that is deep within you? What scripture is inscribed on your heart? In asking this test, Did they believe there was a hierarchy of commandments? Did they think that some were more important than others? Some did. What do you believe? Are some commandments, some parameters of the faith more critical for you than others? In the lectionary podcast this week, Sarah Mickelson makes, I think, a spot-on observation when she says, Jesus is not suggesting that these are a hierarchy, but rather a foundation. Israel, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself, is the foundation of all of the law and all of the prophets. And loving God may be easier than loving your neighbor. It's as if Jesus is saying here, hold this very close, and this is what I think is the second point in this text, at least for me. Hold this foundation very close. Love God with all your heart, and love your neighbor as you love yourself, which is to say, love yourself as well, because you also are a part of God's creation. And then in this text, Jesus flips it. And at the end of these three questions, he now asks them a question. It's as if he's saying, since you are the authority and you have the answer, tell me this, is the Messiah greater than David? That's my paraphrase of it. It's an intricate question, and it involves the quoting of Scripture, and it involves their notion that David was the great leader of all of Israel, and yet also their expectation that the Messiah was going to come. It takes discernment to understand what he's asking here. But I'm paraphrasing it this way. Is what God is doing in your future greater than what you treasure in your past? I give you that question for this week. Do you think it's possible that God could be doing something in your future that's greater than whatever it is that you really treasure in your past? That's the basis for hope. There are some things in my past that I once thought were very, very valuable that now I literally have thrown away. Literally have taken them out and put them into garbage. There are some things in my present that are so extraordinarily precious to me, yet I never imagined that they would be present or valuable when I was in my past. I failed to imagine them. How can we know what it is that is precious for us from the perspective of God? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all of the law and the prophets. They are the foundation out of which we can come to reflect and contemplate and shape ourselves for all of our calls to follow God's commands. This is Reformation Sunday in the Protestant Church. It's a time to think about reforming ourselves, a time to think about returning to the foundation of Scripture and what it teaches us about following God's call. Here's a story about a time I was reformed. It's a story, it's more of an image for me, and I am not clear yet about exactly why it was reforming for me, but I'm clear that it was. I used to drive every day by the intersection of Neptune and Church. Many of you know that intersection, and I would go by very early in the morning there. And often at that intersection, I would see not only the fire station there, and invariably some of the firefighters and paramedics early in the morning standing outside talking or working on the fire truck, but often, like every other day, on the other side of the street, I would see an old man. I mean an old man. He was so old, he was feeble. And he would be walking. He had a walker that he would be using. He was so old, it didn't look he should be out by himself. He had the look about him of being a bit unkempt, disheveled, as if you wondered, was there anybody caring for him? I never saw where he came from. I never knew exactly where he was going, although I speculated, but he was often there. Very often he had a plastic grocery bag with him with that walker, and moving was difficult for him, yet he was persistent. I found myself thinking sometimes, is there anybody that's in this man's family? Who knows this man? The firefighters did. They often would holler a greeting at him as he would pass by, and it warmed me to know that they saw him even as I did. Well, one day, as I was there at the light waiting, the old man was moving in his walker, and he looked especially disheveled. And across that busy intersection, the firefighters were talking, the paramedics there, and all of a sudden, his pants fell down, and he was a mess. You understand what I'm saying? He was a mess. It was the kind of moment that, you know, you in some circles could just see as being full of derision. Ha, 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 look at that man. His pants fell down, completely down around his ankles. And it was a difficult, terrible moment for him because he didn't have the capability to stop and help himself and clean himself or pull himself up. And there in my car, I found myself wondering, what do I do? Where do I go? What's going to come of him? Who will help him? And then I saw those paramedics coming across the street together, putting on their blue gloves and carrying some rags and their own bags to help get him up and clean him up and get him going again. Certainly not their most glorious moment all week, right? Or was it? It was a reforming moment for me as to what was precious and what was important and what loving your neighbor looked like. All month long, I've been quoting St. Francis of Assisi in his prayer. And this is the last Sunday in October, so I think I'll end this section of preaching by quoting him once again. And this time, the last portion of that prayer that so many of you have either written on your heart or certainly is very familiar to you. The last portion goes like this: O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Teacher, tell us, what is the greatest commandment? What would you have said?
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. If my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go every high, every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go. Coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, you never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go every high, every low. Oh no, you never let go. Never let go of me. No, no, never let go through the calm, through the storm.
No, no, never let go
in every high, every low. Oh, no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Lord, you never let go.
Now the service of worship has come to an end. How good it is that in a world that pulls so many things apart, we've been able to draw together for this time of worship. I'm grateful to have shared it with you. Go forth into the world, followers of Jesus Christ, and every time this week that you leave the house or come back inside, try to touch with your heart, with your mind, with your soul, something that's foundational for you to help form you into who you are, into who God has created you to be. Love God and love your neighbor. Go in peace.